Listening Library presents Katie Kazoo Switcheroo, Book 12, No Bones About It, by Nancy Krulik. Read for you by Anne Bobby. Chapter 1. Ouch! Katie Carew shouted. She turned around and stared at Kevin Camilleri. Stop kicking the seat. Kevin grinned at Katie. I didn't do it. George did. George Brennan was sitting next to Kevin on the school bus. The kids in Class 3A were on their way to the Cherrydale Museum of Natural History for a field trip. It wasn't me, George assured Katie.
It must have been a ghost, Kevin joked.
Katie sighed. I don't care who it was, just stop kicking. As Katie turned back around in her seat, one of her best friends, Suzanne Locke, let out a yelp. George, keep your disgusting hands off my ponytail, she shouted. It took me hours to get it right. You're going to ruin it. You mean you meant for it to look like that? George asked. Suzanne looked at Katie. Boys, she huffed. They're all pains in the neck.
Jeremy's not a pain, Katie pointed out. Suzanne rolled her eyes.
He's your friend, Katie, not mine.
It was true.
Jeremy Fox was Katie's other best friend, but he and Suzanne did not get along at all. Katie looked across the aisle. Jeremy was sitting next to Manny Gonzalez. They were making bunny ears over Becky Stern's head. Katie was glad Suzanne didn't see them. It would only prove her point.
Hey, Jeremy! Manny, watch this! George called out. He stuck his tongue out at a passing car.
How about this? Manny said. He squashed his nose and mouth up against the bus window.
You guys better stop that, Katie warned them. If Mrs. Dirkman catches you, you'll be in big trouble.
She's all the way in the front of the bus, George said.
He looked out the window and stuck his tongue out again as another car drove by. Jeremy held up a camera.
Hey, George, say cheese.
George made a funny face as Jeremy snapped a photo.
What was that for? George asked him.
I'm taking pictures of our field trip for the Class 3A Times, Jeremy explained.
He was editor of the class newspaper.
Cool. How about this one? George asked.
He stood up and held his ears straight out as a car passed by.
Mrs. Dirkman will be really mad, Katie reminded them.
George sighed. Katie Kazoo, you're a goody-goody, he exclaimed.
I am not, she insisted. You are too, George told her. You never get in trouble. You never do anything wrong. You're a goody-goody.
Goody-goody, Kevin repeated. Katie is a goody-goody.
Katie is a goody-goody, Manny joined in. Katie is a goody-goody.
The boys' chanting grew louder and louder. Katie's face got redder and redder. She was mad. And she was hurt, too. After all, Katie and George were friends. She'd been the first one to be nice to him when he was the new kid at school. And George was the one who had given Katie her way cool nickname, Katie Kazoo. But George sure wasn't treating Katie like a friend right now. He kept on singing,
Katie is a goody-goody, Katie is a goody-goody.
That's enough! Mrs. Dirkman shouted from the front of the bus. The boys quieted down right away. It's almost the end of the school year. By now, I would expect you to know how to act on a field trip. If you children cannot behave, I will ask Mr. Bloom to turn this bus around right now. We can go back to school and have a math test instead of a field trip, Mrs. Dirkman warned.
Suzanne looked at Katie.
See? I told you boys were rotten.
George was mean, and he was wrong. I'm not a goody-goody, assured Katie.
Well, Suzanne said slowly, not all the time anyway.
What's that supposed to mean? Katie asked her.
Nothing, Suzanne said. It's just that you hardly ever get in trouble.
I do too, Katie insisted.
When?
There was that time Mrs. Dirkman read our note out loud, Katie said. We got in trouble then.
That was months ago, Suzanne reminded her. And I was the one who sent the note in the first place. You were just answering me.
How about the time Mr. Kane caught me with a cell phone?
Suzanne laughed. Me again. It was my cell phone, remember? I brought it to school. You were just holding it when Mr. Kane walked into the cafeteria.
Katie looked across the aisle at Jeremy. You don't think I'm a goody-goody, do you?
Jeremy didn't answer.
Jeremy,
Katie insisted.
It's okay to be a goody-goody, Jeremy said finally. Everybody has to be something. George is funny. Kevin is the tomato man. I'm good at sports.
I'm fashionable, Suzanne added. Mandy's really smart. Zoe's an artist.
And you're a goody-goody, Jeremy finished. It's just who you are.
We like you anyway, Suzanne said. Katie frowned. Somehow, that didn't make her feel any better.
Chapter 2. As the bus rolled along, Katie stared out the window. She tried not to think about what her friends had said, but she couldn't help it, especially since George and Kevin kept whispering, "Goody, goody, goody, goody," into her ear. Katie wanted to ask Mrs. Dirkman to make them stop, but telling on the boys would only make her seem like more of a goody-goody. The truth was, George couldn't be more wrong. Katie had actually gotten into trouble lately. Lots of trouble. In the past few months, Katie had wound up in the boys' locker room, started a food fight in the cafeteria, and completely ruined Becky's report on Cleopatra. She'd also wrecked part of Mrs. Dirkman's prized garden. George would have loved to have seen that. But none of Katie's friends knew about the trouble she had gotten into. How could they? All those things had happened when Katie had magically turned into someone else. But Katie couldn't tell her friends that. They would never believe her. Katie wouldn't believe it either if it hadn't happened to her. But it really did happen. Katie Carew turned into other people. A lot. It all started one day at the beginning of the school year. Katie had lost the football game for her team, ruined her favorite pair of pants, and let out a big burp in front of the whole class. It was the worst day of Katie's life. That night, Katie had wished she could be anyone but herself. There must have been a shooting star overhead when she made that wish, because the very next day, the magic wind came and turned Katie into Speedy the class hamster. Katie had escaped from the hamster cage and wound up in the boys' locker room, stuck inside George's stinky sneaker. Luckily, Katie had turned back into herself before George could step on her. The magic wind came back again and again. It turned her into Lucille, the lunch lady. And Katie had started a food fight with some really gooey egg salad. The wind had turned her into other kids, too, like Jeremy and Becky. Once the magic wind had even turned Katie into her very own dog, Pepper. That time, she'd chased a particularly nasty squirrel into Mrs. Dirkman's yard and had destroyed her teacher's favorite troll statue. Katie never knew when the magic wind would come back again. All she knew was that when it did, she was going to wind up getting into some sort of trouble, and so would the person she'd turn into. See? Katie wasn't a goody-goody at all. Unfortunately, she was the only person who knew it. Chapter 3. Okay, class. Follow me, Mrs. Dirkman said, as she walked up the stone staircase that led to the museum. Remember, we have to be on our best behavior. A tall, skinny man with a thin tuft of hair on his head walked over to greet the class.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.